welcome.
Okay, Job chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, and then verses 25 through 26. All right, so Job chapter 3. I know where I'm going. I just hope you can keep up with me this morning. But today is sermon number 5. In our series, Lessons from the Life of Job, When God Allows Satan to Attack. This is also the 5th out of 6 sermons dealing with how Satan attacks. And so today I want to preach on how Satan attacks your mind. Now the purpose of this series, as I've stated every single week, is to give us a knowledge of how the enemy attacks. Because when we have this knowledge, we're more equipped, we're better able to withstand his attacks and stay faithful to God. Because ultimately we want to stay faithful to God, right? Right. I hope that that's your end goal, stay faithful to God. Well, in order to do that, you have to be equipped to be able to withstand the attacks. And that's what this sermon series is all about. A couple of things I want you to understand about the attacks from the enemy is that, number one, God allows or lets the enemy or Satan attack Job's life. And at times, God allows the enemy to attack our lives. Number two, once Satan starts attacking, he will build on the previous attacks. Okay? We see that very crystal clear as we go through this, and it'll become even more clear this morning, that when Satan begins attacking you, he builds on each attack. Satan first accused Job before God and attacked his relationship with God. Then he built on that attack by taking the lives of his children, his servants, and his wealth. For whatever reason, Satan left Job's wife alive and attacked Job's marriage. Right? He's progressing here. And while all of this is going on, Job's health is attacked. So Satan attacks Job's health. And he covers his body from the soles of his feet to the top of his head with these boils, all right? These sores, which makes it look like he's cursed by God at this point. And because all of this was raining down on Job, he began to feel sorry for himself, to have self-pity. And so Satan builds each attack off the previous attack. And now he has Job wallowing in self-pity, right? So while he's wallowing in this self-pity, the door is open for the enemy to attack his mind. And that's where I want to spend some time today, is how the enemy attacks our mind. When God allows Satan to attack, he will attack your mind. Job chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, and then we'll jump down to verse 25. After this, Job opened his mouth and cursed the day of his birth. And Job spoke and said, "May the day perish on which I was born, and the night in which it was said, a male child is conceived. May that day be darkness. May God above not seek it, nor the light shine upon it." Verse 25. "For the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded has happened to me. I am not at ease, nor am I quiet. I have no rest, for trouble comes." Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this privilege, Lord, that we had to gather together as a group of believers worshiping you. And God, there's a lot that we don't know. God, there's probably more that we don't know than what we do know, but God, we thank you for what we do know, and that is that Jesus Christ lives. And that is through Him that we can obtain eternal life. It is through Him that we know that everything in life will work out for our good and for your glory. So God, we come today giving you praise. We come today worshiping you because you are God. And God, I know that in a crowd this size, there's some who are going through hard times, struggling. May not be to the depth of Job, but still it's hard and it's difficult just to navigate through each day. And so God, I pray for each and every person that may be today. Lord, I pray for each one who may have those days ahead. Lord, that you be with them, that you see them, comfort them, minister to them. Lord, but above all, I pray that you're with them, that they might withstand the attacks of the enemy. God, open our minds and our hearts that we might receive what you put before us this day. God, I pray that you'll use my lips for your service. Hide me behind the cross, that you and only you might be exalted. We'll give you thanks, give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to start off by saying, as I look over the crowd here, I think pretty highly of all of you here. There's not one in here that I think any less of. I look over the crowd, I think pretty highly of everyone in this room. Number one, because you chose to be here to hear a word from God, to hear a message from God to speak to you. Number two, I'm glad that you're, or I think highly of you, because I think many of you would handle things like Job handled things. See, Job is commended. Job ought to be commended for the way he handled all of this adversity. As a matter of fact, there's an old saying about someone who has endured or experienced and persevered through trials that they have the patience of Job. You heard that before? They've had the patience of Job. And so Job is commended for the way he withstood, the way he persevered through this trial. And I believe that you guys would handle things much the way Job handled things. I mean, amongst the elite in the Bible, as far as men of God go, Job is right near the top. I mean, I would put him in the likes of Joseph, Joshua, Samuel. I mean, these are some great men of God that we don't really see anything recorded negatively that they did. We don't really see no major sin or flaws in their life, and I don't think we can see that in Job's life. And so Job's up there amongst the elite when it comes to men of the Bible. So to be compared to Job would be a great compliment to anyone. All right? And I believe that you're on that level. I believe that all of you are probably on that level. I believe that most of you here this morning would handle adversity much like Job did. And what I mean by that is most of you would never curse God. You would never curse God no matter what happens in your life. I believe that most of you would probably be like that. You know, it may be hard. It may be immensely difficult. And you may struggle. But I don't believe that you would curse God. But you, like Job, may lose focus and move your eyes from Jesus to your problems. And that's what Job did. He never cursed God. Even though Job's eyes moved from God to his own calamity, he did not ever one time curse God. He did, however, curse the day he was born, which we just read in the first part of chapter 3, which God had a major part in. Okay? He didn't outright curse God, but he's like, I wish I was never born. I wish God would have never have made me. I wish God would have never allowed me to be conceived. So he never really cursed God, but yet he cursed the day he's born. And I think that that's probably the category that most of us would fall. We probably never curse God because we know God is real, right? And he's powerful, and we don't want to stoop to that level. But we may get to a point to say, you know what? I wish I was never born. I wish God would have never have done this or never have done that. May not ever curse God, but we may curse days in our life or the day that we were born. So I think that we can understand where Job is. Now let me share with you a couple of disclaimers before I dissect how the enemy attacks our minds. Number one, and these are things, very important things to remember. Number one, Satan nor any of those who do his bidding can read your mind. Okay? Satan cannot read your mind or know your thoughts. That's the point that I was driving home without talking about Satan to the kids. All right? Nobody can read your mind except God. All right? He's the only one who knows your thoughts. He's the only one who knows what's going on in your heart and in your mind. The last part of 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 39, in case you need a scripture to back up what I'm saying, I got one. 1 Kings chapter 8, the last part of 39 says, "For you alone know the hearts of all the sons of men." In other words, God alone knows the thoughts. No one else knows the thoughts that you think. Not even Satan. Satan is a created being. He cannot read your thoughts. He cannot read your heart. That's good news to those who thought Satan could read your mind. Because that's not an uncommon thought in church. There's a lot of people sitting on church pews who do think that Satan can read their mind. He can't read your mind. Okay? You're safe. Your mind is safe from him reading it or knowing your thoughts. Okay? So you're safe. Only God knows your thoughts. Now, I don't know which is scarier. Satan knowing my thoughts or God knowing my thoughts. Alright? You do with that whatever you have to do with that, right? I say deal with your thoughts at the altar. That's my take if you're having thoughts that aren't what they should be. But the enemy may not know what you're thinking, and he doesn't, but he certainly knows how to read you. Alright? He studied you. He knows you. He knows how you act. He knows your weaknesses. And so he knows how to read you, and he knows your feelings. He knows when you're happy, when you're sad, because we don't keep that stuff to ourselves. We can't disguise those things. And so he reads people. He's probably the best people reader ever created. So he may not know what you're thinking, but he knows how to read you. Second disclaimer, okay? The first one being that Satan can't read your mind. He don't know your thoughts. Second disclaimer, Satan can't make you do anything. Okay? Satan can't make you do anything. He can tempt you, but he cannot control you. Okay? Satan can tempt you. The enemy can tempt you. He can dangle a carrot in front of you, but he cannot control you. He cannot make you do something. Okay? No one can ever use the excuse that the devil made me do it. That will not fly. All right? The devil did not make you do anything. If Satan could make us do things, if he could make us do things, then he would already make Job curse God. Okay? And so, Satan can't make you do anything. Satan can't read your mind. He does not know your thoughts. Okay? So, if Satan could make us do things, just another example, if Satan could make us do things, then we shouldn't and wouldn't be held accountable for the sins that we commit, right? If Satan can make us sin, if Satan can make us do things that we don't want to do or whatever, if he can make us do things, then we shouldn't and we wouldn't be held accountable for the sins that we commit. And everybody would make it to heaven. But that's not the case. The things you do are your responsibility. I don't care what other kind of influences you have. If I come and I lash out at Sonia, all right, because she burnt my toast, all right? And I'll lash out at her. All right? That doesn't give me a chance to blame her for my lashing out because I'm in control of me, right? I can't blame that on her. I can't put that on her. So the things we do are our responsibility, all right? Even if Satan is tempting you to do it, it's still your responsibility. So, if Satan can't read our minds and thoughts, and he can't make us do anything, then how is it that he can attack our minds? So, if he can't read our thoughts, read our minds, and he can't make us do anything, then how is it that he can attack our mind? And that's a very good question. First of all, he waits until you're at the low point of life. He waits until you're at a low point before he attacks your mind. Okay? Till you're in the dumps. How many of you would agree that Job is at a low point here, right?
Amen.
He is low, right? I mean, he has just been devastated by these acts that were coming against him. All right? So he is going through a hard time. He's mourning his children, right? All of his children are gone. His servants are gone. His wife is mad at him right now, or maybe mad at him because he just said, "Woman, you're acting like the foolish women," right? That would make my wife mad. So his wife's mad at him. He's got sores from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet, right? Now he's got friends crying around him, and he's laying in ashes. I mean, he's at a low point in his life. Satan attacks our minds at low points in our life. I'm going to give you a couple examples of how our minds are attacked. One's kind of silly, but real. All right, very real for me. And the other one, I'll use it to show how it affects our walk with God, with our walk with Christ. Okay? So the first example of how this works, and this is the silly example. This week, Sonia, Celeste, and myself have been on a green smoothie cleanse. I'm not going to call it a diet thingy. Thank you, by the way. Appreciate that. Sean, my sympathies, brother. So that's what I've been doing for the last 5 days. I say 5 days because Saturday and today, not happening. Okay? Now, we can eat raw vegetables. You know, we eat raw vegetables. I mean, but I can't even stomach celery when I'm going to eat pizza. Okay? So we can eat raw vegetables and fruit and nuts and things like that. And no, I did not give up Diet Sundrop, okay? I didn't give that up. I wasn't ready to deal with the headaches that come along with no caffeine. So I don't know how much of a cleanse I got. But don't hate, because I'm standing in front of you today 9 pounds lighter than I was last Sunday, right? I'm telling you, it's not for the faint of heart, though. But I haven't even gotten to my point yet, okay? So we went through this thing this week. So by the time Friday... We started Monday morning, so by the time Friday 1:30 p.m. rolled around, all I could think about was biscuits, and crackers, and cheeseburgers, and pizza. And that's just what I wanted for lunch, okay? That's what was rolling through my mind. My mind was under attack, okay? I was weak. I was at a low point. I'm having... flashbacks. So. I was at a low point, and everything I looked at reminded me of the food that I couldn't eat. This is the honest to God's truth, okay? I was like, I ain't doing it. I would rather walk across the state of North Carolina covered in Legos barefooted than to take another sip of a green smoothie. I ain't doing it. That was my mindset on Friday. I know that's kind of silly, and for those of you who are Facebook fans, you know what I was doing there. That's kind of silly, but I'm sure that we all have experienced something like that in life, right? At some point, the enemy was making my mind think. The enemy wasn't making my mind think about pizza, but he sure was making everything look like pizza. That's the way he attacked my mind this week. And that's kind of silly. And I said that just to kind of give you an idea, because we've all experienced something along those lines. But there are other examples. There's other examples. On a serious note, I know a family who lost a loved one in a tragic accident. Very tragic, 18-year-old kid. And one of the family members witnessed the accident. And every time they would hear a siren, whether it be a police, an ambulance, or a fire siren, they would just break down. It was so tragic. The enemy was attacking their mind, but bringing them back to that day. I know another family who received tragic news of a family member dying in an accident while they were in church. No, the person didn't die in church. The person died in an accident and the family was in church. Okay? And so they were sitting in the pew whenever somebody came in and told them about this accident. And for over 10 years, that mom could never step foot back in the church again. Not just that church, but any church. Couldn't do it. Because every time she stepped back into the church, she was reminded of that day. That tragic day when her son was killed in an accident. I know another older lady who lost her dad. And her dad was the one who brought her to church, introduced her to church, and she was so active in church. She was there every Sunday, taught Sunday school, always in church. Where her father passed away. He was in his 80s. Passed away. We had the service there at the church. But she could never come back. Because every time she felt like she stepped through that door, it would bring her back to the day she lost her dad. So she couldn't do it. And so that was her mind being attacked. These are just a few things that I've seen in the lives of people that I've pastored over the years. These are true stories. And I've seen them with my own eyes where I could see clearly the enemy was attacking their minds. He wasn't in their minds. He wasn't making them think these things. But he was certainly bringing things to their attention that would take them back. He wasn't making them think these things, but he was surrounding them with things that would take them back to the tragedy. And we see that happening in Job. The enemy wants you to be consumed by the loss in your life. That's why I love that song, Father Alone. Because when you sing that, you know, okay, I have this loss, but not all is lost. Because Father Alone will know all about it. We'll know what and why these things happen. The enemy wants you to be consumed by the loss in your life, and he'll stop at nothing to remind you and keep you in that burdened state. He wants to keep you in that burdened state. He wants you in that state because he knows that you'll be ineffective for the kingdom. If he can keep you in a burdened state, constantly thinking about the loss that you've had, then you will be ineffective for the kingdom because you are consumed by loss. Now, loss doesn't have to be of a loved one, right? That's one of the most common losses that we talk about. That was a big loss to Job. But that's not all Job lost here. Okay? Yes, he lost his children. He lost his servants. Job lost his wealth as well. Okay? He didn't have a job anymore. Okay? That was pretty big. That would be pretty big if you guys were all of a sudden told, hey, look, you're fired or you're no longer going to receive a check. You got to do something about it. Cutting your retirement off, no more Social Security, whatever it is. That's where he was. It was gone. That's a huge loss. He lost his health too. And if you ever received a diagnosis, cancer, Parkinson's, whatever, diabetes even. I mean, those are hard diagnoses to swallow. Satan attacks your health. Sometimes that's what we focus on. Sometimes everything reminds us of those losses that we have. And when we're reminded of those losses, when we're focusing on those losses, sometimes we are not able to be what we need to be for the kingdom. So Job here was not in any position to witness about God's love and faithfulness. He wasn't in any position to witness about God, to lead someone to God, because he was consumed with his loss, with what he no longer had. He was consumed with what he no longer had. See, the enemy attacks our minds by showing us or reminding us of what we don't have. He attacks our minds by reminding us or showing us what we don't have. I believe that's one of the reasons why America is in the shapes it's in. I believe that's why we are moving further and further away from God, because we can't be what we need to be for God if we're constantly looking at what we don't have. Far too many people are consumed today with what they don't have or what they have lost and lose sight of what they do have. Call that keeping up with the Joneses, right? Well, I don't have this, I don't have that, and we're so focused on what we don't have that we can't do anything for the kingdom. For 7 days, Job lays in ashes, and his friends are there mourning with him. No one is saying a word. All Job sees is loss and despair. All Job sees is loss and despair. He sees no hope. He sees no relief. He feels as if God has abandoned him. That's his thoughts. That's where his heart is right now. Now, we know that's not the case, right? And it's easy looking from the outside in. It's a lot harder when you're in the middle of it, when you're the one going through that. And that's why I'm preaching this today. Because one day you might be where Job is. And you need to know that if you're wanting to withstand the attack of the enemy, you need to know how he attacks. And here's what he's going to do. When you're low, he's going to remind you of what you don't have. When you're low, he's going to remind you of what you've lost. So here Job is laying in ashes, his friends around him, warning, he sees no hope, sees no relief. He feels as if God has abandoned him. But we know, you know, I'm telling you today, that that's not the case. God is still in control. God is still with Job. Satan has taken Job's worst fear and made it a reality and keeps reminding him of it. Look at verse 25. Job says, "For the thing I greatly fear has come upon me." Job's greatest fear must have been to lose everything he had, his children, his wealth, his servants. His greatest fear has come upon him. "And what I dreaded has happened to me. I am not at ease." In other words, he don't have peace. He don't have peace. "Nor am I quiet. I have no rest, for trouble comes." He can't see God. All he sees is his loss. All he sees is his tragedy. All he sees is what he don't have. You see, Satan painted a picture around him that will remind him of what he don't have, of his loss. So that's what Satan does. When he attacks your mind, no, he can't get in your mind, no, he can't control you. But if he can surround you with things that take you back to your loss, that take you back to your tragedy, to take you back to those low points in your life, then that's what he's going to do. He's going to send out those triggers.
Amen.
Because Satan made Job's worst fear a reality, it begins to mess with his mind. Satan's not in his head, but Satan knows his worst fear and surrounds him with it, which leads Job to wish he was never born. That's what this whole chapter is about. That's why I didn't read the whole chapter, because you can see in this chapter Job getting deeper and deeper and deeper into depression. See, this is when the poetry part of Job sets up. And it really paints a dark and dreary picture of where Job is, the low point that he really is. And so this is simply a poem about how much he wishes he was never born. It speaks to the depth of Job's depression. Throughout the chapter, Job says things like he wishes that he was a stillborn baby. And we read just a moment ago that he wishes that he was never born. Verse 3, "May the day perish on the which I was born," or the night he was conceived. And it goes on to say, "In the night in which he was said, a male child is conceived." He wished he was never even conceived. Satan's not telling him this stuff. Satan's not telling him to say this stuff, but because of this devastation and this destruction that Satan has done around Job, Job can only think about wishing he was never born. Obviously, Job is an extreme case. And I hope that none of us ever, ever have to go through even a millionth of what Job went through. But we are susceptible to the enemy attacking our minds. If you feel like, as we close, that your mind is under attack and the enemy keeps putting reminders in front of you, reminding you of your loss and what you don't have, then let me encourage you this morning to lift your eyes to Jesus. Lift your eyes to Jesus. Well, how do you do that, Pastor? How do you do that? Simply, it's a great time of year to do this. Start thanking God for what you do have, for what time you did have with your loved one, if it's over a loss. See, November is a great time of Thanksgiving, right? Because we celebrate Thanksgiving. And one of the things I always like to encourage around this time of year is to take a moment and just say a Thanksgiving prayer. Thank God for everything. Everything that you can think of. As a matter of fact, maybe each day begin to write down the things that you're thankful for. I guarantee you, you could probably write a book of things that you're thankful for. We did that one year around Thanksgiving with our youth group. And we just went around the room, and each one of them wanted to say something they were thankful for. And we went around that group probably 100 times, took up an hour and a half just naming things that we were thankful for. And that's young people, 15, 16-year-old kids. How much more do we have to be thankful for? Don't let loss keep you from being what God would have you to be for the kingdom. But rather use the loss to promote the King and the kingdom. And I asked Miss Linda if I could use her as an example. Many of you know that she and Eddie Earl and their family suffered a tragic loss when they lost their grandchild to cancer, brain cancer, right? That's something that Linda and Eddie Earl and the family could have just said, you know what? Be consumed with their loss, lose focus. But that's not what Linda chose to do. Linda chose to take that loss to promote the King and the kingdom. So she started this project called Covered by Grace. And so what she does periodically in memory of her granddaughter is collects blankets and toys and things like that. And she makes a run every so many months up to Duke Children's Hospital. And she passes those things out, or they pass those things out to the children who are going through there. So you want to know, well, how do you deal with loss? Well, you don't keep looking around at how devastated it is. You look around and say, okay, how can I impact the kingdom? And you've went through it. There's nothing going to change what you've gone through. But what can you do to honor Christ and to honor your loss? And each situation is different. I just use that example because that's probably one of the greatest examples I've seen. Our minds are a battlefield. Okay? Our minds are a battlefield in the spiritual war that is waging. The only way to win the battle of the mind is to surrender your heart and life to Jesus. The only way to win the battle of the mind is to surrender your heart and life to Jesus. You tired of the war in your mind? Then come to Jesus.